topic is the investing insights for the next decade. So in my experience, I've seen this, you know, when it comes to world of investing, there are certain mega trends, you know, that play out globally or in any economy at some point of time. And these mega trends are very long-term trends which play out over 5, 10, 15 years. As investors, if you can capture those mega trends, then investing becomes pretty easy because you can identify underlying businesses which align to those trends. And you know, it becomes pretty easy. Last 10 years, it's been 10 years since the last global financial crisis or the last recession the world saw in 2009. And we are 10 years from that, probably the global economy has peaked. Obviously, there are questions whether we are at the end of this cycle or not. And we'll discuss those questions, but more important. And we've seen some of these large mega trends which have played out over the last 10 years, and the kind of wealth creation that has happened because of that is just mind-boggling. What technology has done in US or what consumers has done in India and so on and so forth. The question is now, can we identify with foresight the trend which probably will play out in India for the next 5, 10, 15 years, and with that, will that help you know, build our portfolios? So I'm going to touch on about 5 or 6 of such mega trends which I think will probably play out in India and probably will be the next driver of wealth creation or the leaders of wealth creation in Indian context. And then post that, I'll probably spend some time talking about a bit of our philosophy. Yeah. So this is what I call, when you play those mega trends, these are trends or companies underlying these trends are companies which generally tend to do very high rate of, in any ecosystem, irrespective of whatever the growth of the economy or that ecosystem is, there are always components of ecosystem which are growing at a rate which are much higher than what that ecosystem is growing. Yeah. So look at US, for example. US economy is growing at 2% or 2.5% over the last 10 years, but there are technology companies which have grown at 25-30% CAGR. So this is what I call in the investing parlance, I you know, call it as big wave surfing. I don't know if anyone is familiar with surfing as a sport, then you've seen in surfing or you would have seen somewhere in TV commercial something, you have these big wave surfers who surf on this high waves. They don't surf on the low waves, which is presumed to be pretty risky. But people who really do that, they don't perceive that as a risky sport. So the idea as an investor is to identify companies which are riding that high wave and probably will continue to ride that high wave for the next 10, 15 years. And if you can do that as an investor, then I'm sure there's a lot of money to be made. Yeah. So the first big trend that I see for India and probably will sustain over the next 15, 20 years is what I call cramps as an opportunity. To me, I started my career as an IT analyst way back in 96. To me, the cram sector in India is exactly where the IT sector was in India in the early 90s or the mid 90s. And we have seen what has happened to the IT sector in India. Today, our IT exports are exceeding $130 billion or so. That's for Indian companies. If you take the captives here, that number is much higher. The key advantage India had when it came to IT sector was very simple. We had low-cost manpower. Globally, all the Fortune 500 companies, the large companies which were spending billions of dollars on their technology, because they were going through a slowdown and so on and so forth, the chief technology officer in those companies wanted to achieve more IT efficiency or more IT productivity with the same amount of fixed budget. And the solution was Indian IT companies, yeah, where the same work, as opposed to being done in US onshore, if it was done in Bangalore or Hyderabad, was done at 40% of cost, and there was 60% cost saving which the Indian companies and the customers shared between themselves. I think the whole cramps sector is exactly at that kind of inflection point. Today, most of the global healthcare companies, they are significantly challenged on their R&D budget because globally, the life cycle of a successful molecule has reduced because of increased competition. R&D budgets have increased exponentially because of rising manpower costs. Yeah? And the chief of R&D of all of these healthcare companies, let's say a Pfizer or a Baxter, is challenged where he has to do more work on more molecules with the same fixed amount of budgets. And the solution to them lies with India. A PhD in biology or a chemistry in US somewhere would cost you $100,000. The same guy you can get in Bangalore or Hyderabad for some $30,000-$40,000. And there is a cost arbitrage of $50,000-$60,000. So I think companies which can capitalize on these opportunities, both on the contract research and manufacturing, India, because of our availability of large pool of skilled talent, is going to play a pretty vital role. And I think this is a trend which is going to continue for the next 10, 15 years. So I think cramps as an opportunity for India is very significant, very significant. And the drivers are very sustainable and very long-term. Yeah. The next big trend I see in India is India's internet economy. You've seen what has happened with the technology has done globally over the last 20 years. India's internet economy has just started taking shape. Thanks to Jio, smartphone penetration in India has now gone 3x. We have 800 million smartphone users, and that will go to about cross 100 million in the next 12 or 18 months. India now has the second largest user base in smartphones globally after China. In every other metrics that I look at, yeah, in terms of time spent on internet, time spent or the number of Google app downloads, time spent on each of the apps, and so on and so forth. And if you look at for all the large global companies, you know, large part of their consumer base or customer base comes from India. Yeah, just think it about from a perspective of an internet company. If our smartphone penetration has gone from 270 million to 800 million in the last 2.5 years, 30 months or so, for a company which has business which is based on internet, their potential customers have multiplied 3 times in a matter of 30 months. In any business, if your potential customers multiply 3 times in a matter of 3 years, then what your ability to mine those customers and drive your business can just be exponential. I think India's internet economy is just taking shape, and probably over the next 15, 20 years, it's going to become very big wave. Companies which can really ride this wave and capitalize on that, I think there'll be a huge amount of wealth creation that'll happen in this sector. Consumption has been a secular wave in India and will continue to remain so for the next 20 or 25 years. Just that as we go through different phases of evolution now, we've reached some important milestone in our growth journey where now we are at about $2,500 of per capita income. As we keep going across milestones and keep reaching new milestones, the consumption basket will keep changing. Yeah. So probably now that we've reached this milestone, probably people spend, there are enough number of high savers in the economy, and they'll end up spending meaningful amount on discretionary spend than staples. So consumption will remain a long-term story, but I think the consumption baskets will keep changing, where we'll see a more tilt towards discretionary consumption versus staple consumption. But consumption as a story is here to say. That does not necessarily mean you have to buy all the consumer companies. They're extremely rich. Don't extrapolate straight away the macro themes to micro themes. Underlying companies can have different this thing, drivers. I think the fourth big theme is financialization. I'm sure all of us are part of it, and many of us know about it. But as you know, India as an economy, we have savings in our culture. As the economy grows and per capita income keeps rising, financial sector is the core or fulcrum of the economy, and it has a very vital role to play in each and every aspects of it. So from a traditional financing of you know, just about credit or loans and so on and so forth, I think the whole managing the savings ecosystem, be it with asset management companies or wealth management or with insurance and security and all of that, all of these will play a very exponential role, whether it has to do with our pension savings or retirement savings and so on and so forth. So I think all of this will have a very important role to play, whether it's to do with our life cycle savings or whether it's to do with credit or the savings side of it or the wealth creation side of it. So I think financials as a theme probably will do well, and there are different parts of the ecosystem which will do significantly well. And last not but least, I think if you see our industrial economy has been in a significant slowdown over the last 5 or 6 years, but I can see pointers where probably it seems that we have touched the low point of our growth. And if you take the next 5 to 7 years view, then I think India's growth will recover, and there are sectors which have not done well, but next leg of India's growth has to be driven by investments. And if that be the case, then a lot of sectors, including domestic economy oriented sectors, be it autos, which are at a 15-year low, utilities, industrials, logistics, as the economy grows, all of these sectors should do well. These sectors are on a cyclical low. So that's the another one in terms of way we look at things over the next 10 or 15 years. I can just quickly touch upon you know, how we weave all of this into our investing. So as I always say, there's something called the four pillars of investing. Usually investors look at performance, but unfortunately, you know, performance is just an outcome. What goes into performance is more importantly to have a right investing philosophy, back that up with process, and eventually have a good team to run that. I think investment philosophy is very important for any investor. Philosophy, to my mind, is like a religion. You know, just like investors who truly follow a philosophy, for them, philosophy is like a religion. Generally, most of us don't change our religion during the course of a life cycle. Likewise, an investor, once he's wedded to a philosophy, doesn't change his philosophy once he really believes into it in the course of it. It does two things. One, it brings significant amount of clarity of purpose from a outside world perspective, because once you know what the clear philosophy of the investor is, you know what to expect out of him. And always there'll be points of time when markets will not do well or certain funds will not do well. Once you have a clarity on the philosophy of the investor, then you really know what to expect out of him, and during bad times, what are the downsides of that philosophy or that approach. So it's very important to understand the philosophy of this thing. As I always say, that as investors, we are essentially focused, growth. One simple philosophy that we practice is growth, because equity is a growth asset. We just want to buy into high growth businesses, some of them which are riding those big wave, and just hold them for a long period of time. And as long as we can keep doing that, I think we'll do well over a period of time. Those businesses can go through their own cycles, but and which is what I call, I think globally investors understand GARP very well, which is growth at reasonable price. But I believe in Indian context, while growth is important, what is equally important is the sustainability of the growth and good quality of that growth. Because at times you get a lot of poor quality growth, and at times you get growth which you get in periods of phases, but growth doesn't last long. If you really want your wealth to compound over a long period of time, then you really want growth which will sustain over a long period of time. Only when then the compounding effect will work. So what I say is, while GARP is good in the global context, in Indian context, what we need is sustainable quality growth to really drive long-term returns from equities. Generally, people believe that to generate high returns in equities, one has to take high risk. I mean, that's the common refrain I always get, or common response I get. Unfortunately, the correlation between risk and return in equity is not linear. It's a bell-shaped curve, as we've learned in our academics. So investors who eventually end up taking high risk do not make the highest returns. They in fact actually make low returns. To generate superior returns in equities over a long period of time, what you actually need to do is to take moderate risk, because there is a point of inflection beyond that. If you take high risk, then your returns, incremental returns, actually starts declining rather than increasing. So the correlation between equity and, as I said, risk and return in equity is not linear. It's a bell-shaped curve. If you're here, if you're a highest risk taker, you're somewhere here on the curve. And your outcome is not the highest returns, but probably one of the lowest returns. So probably if you want to generate superior returns or high returns, you have to be somewhere here on the risk curve. So it's important to understand what we try to achieve in equity, and which is why I say that the endeavor, if you are here in this game for a long period of time, the endeavor should be to generate superior risk-adjusted returns. You need to understand what risk you are taking in your portfolio. And highest risk might not translate into the highest returns. Risk is a very nebulous subject, meaning one can give long this thing, discourse on that. But very specifically, I think the two most important risks from equity investor perspective is, one is what I call the mortality risk. And that's very simple. With evolution and technological disruptions, life cycle of businesses are becoming narrower and narrower. And on top of that, obviously, in India, we have a lot of corporate governance issues in many cases. So the mortality in the context of investing effectively means you invest into a business and the business doesn't survive. In which case, as an equity owner of the, as an owner of the business, you lose 100% of capital. It's very important to avoid mortality risk in a portfolio, because in which case, if you invest into a business and if the business doesn't survive, you lose 100% of your capital, right? So as I say, the first question you need to ask yourself every time you invest into a business is, presume that there is a global financial crisis tomorrow, and will that business survive that or not? If the answer is no, don't bother investing into that business. Because at some point of time or other, there'll be a crisis. And if the business is not sound enough or strong enough fundamentally, then it will not survive that. Even if you made returns in the interim, you will end up losing all of that. So it's important to understand that. And second is wall. Essentially, you want to have low walls portfolio so that your drawdowns when markets fall are much lower. So it's important to have that. We run two strategies on the PMS portfolio, what I call the large cap fund and the mid cap fund, the business leadership fund. I briefly touch upon both of them in quick 30 seconds. This is what I call a concentrated large cap portfolio. My view is very simple. I say this, that if you're, as an investor, if you're happy with more or less about 12 to 14, 15% CAGR returns over a long period of time on your equity portfolio, I tell investors that you should largely be a large cap investor in India. Over a medium term to long term, probably India's nominal GDP growth will be about 10-12%. And if that be the case, then we enough number of large cap companies in India which can do a 15-20% CAGR growth and much higher. If you can get a portfolio of those companies, 10-15 such companies, you are done with it. You've got your 15% return. All of us love mid caps, small caps, and all of that. What we fail to realize is while mid caps, small caps give high returns or potentially high returns, those returns come with pretty high risk. Yeah? And the core of an investor's portfolio has to be in large caps. Secondly, when it comes to large caps, I don't think so you need a diversified portfolio. I firmly believe that over a period of time. And when it comes to large caps, I think given multiple changes that have happened, diversified mutual funds, large cap portfolios will find it very difficult to beat the benchmarks. This is something which has happened globally. In India, we're already seeing that only 25-30% of the large cap funds in the mutual fund industry will be able to beat benchmarks or the Nifty. Yeah? And your ability to identify which 25 or 30% will beat that will become increasingly challenging. If you can create a portfolio of 10-15 such large cap companies, which can do a 15-20% earnings CAGR or a 3 to 4 year cycle, your job is done. You don't need much more than that. And because it's large cap, I like to believe that this is a pretty low risk equity portfolio. Because it's large cap, people think concentration is risk. When it comes to large cap, I think concentration also means high conviction. And that is what you want. You don't want diversified portfolios or focused portfolios when it comes to large caps. What you need is concentrated portfolios. You need focused portfolios when it comes to mid caps and small caps, but not in case of large caps. Because focused portfolios, in fact, actually can be counterproductive to risk. So that's one fund that we run. And the other fund we run is what I call the business leadership fund. The idea is very simple. I'm sure all of us love mid caps because there's always hunt or search for the next multi-bagger, yeah, which is what mid-caps are all about. But what we fail to realize is that those returns come at a pretty high risk. For every company, every successful company goes through this growth cycle where it is a startup at some point of time and then it becomes large and mature and goes through this journey. But for every one company which goes through this life cycle, there are 99 those companies who fail, invariably fail. Now, and if a company fails, which is what we talked about, mortality risk, then the question is, how do you identify those companies at an early stage in their life cycle? Because if it fails, you lose 100% of your capital. And my answer to that is very simple. We think that companies, they are mid or small, and then they become large, and then they become business leaders. My view is that's not the case. Companies which eventually go on and become large are leaders in their respective business even when they are mid or small. There is something special about those companies in terms of their DNA, in terms of their competitive edge, in terms of their management capabilities, which sets them apart even when they are mid and small. So the idea with this, and which is why they become large. It's not that they become large and then they become business leaders. It's the other way around. Which is why the idea with this fund, and which is why we call it a business leadership fund, is to invest into companies while these companies are mid cap or small caps, but they have to be amongst the leaders in their business. They have to be amongst the top three or top five players in this industry. And that can only happen when they have some competitive edge or a unique edge over their peers. And if they have that, that effectively means two things. One, they'll survive any down cycle in the business because of their edge. And if they can do that, and if that edge has to be sustainable, they should deliver growth over a long period of time. And if they keep continuing growing, then over a period of 10-15 years, there is no reason why they should not become very large companies. I can give you a few examples of this. I have it. Meaning, this is a classic example of a company, which
until two-wheeler is a fairly mature industry in India. Even 10 years back, it's an industry which was fairly matured. Yeah. iShare used to be a very small company. When it came to two-wheeler in 2010-11, they used to sell like something like 50, 60,000 motorcycles per annum, which is like 4, 5,000 a month. And that was at a time when Hero used to sell something like 5 lakhs or 5.5 lakhs motorcycles in a month. So it was an industry which is fairly matured, it was a kind of oligopoly kind of a structure because of 3 or 4 players in the industry. And because they behaved well, each of them was making good profits and good ROC. Now, iShare somewhere in their journey, they realized that if they were to launch a motorcycle and compete with any of these players, it would have been very, very difficult for them to compete with them because the existing players, their brands, their products are so superior and they're so well entrenched, there's no way they could have competed with them. And we've seen a lot of failures in the two-wheeler industry. I don't know, for example, M&M launched a two-wheeler sometime back and they tried for a few years and they actually couldn't succeed. Probably these guys are a bit smarter where they realize that if India keeps growing, and India has a fairly high level of two-wheeler penetrations. Even those days, we used to sell like 8 million or about 10 million two-wheelers a year, 1 crore two-wheelers a year, which is pretty large. And we've been doing that for the last 25, 30 years. They realize that at some point of time, India's per capita income will grow, and there will be some percentage of customers who would want to upgrade themselves or own a high-powered two-wheeler, which is much higher on power and so on. And they said instead of competing with these guys, they positioned themselves to be slightly ahead of time, and they had this two-wheeler, which is 350cc Bullet. I'm sure most of us or many of us know about it. And the segment at that time was virtually non-existent when they acquired this Bullet. It was a UK company originally. They acquired sometime, I think, 2004 or 5, struggled with it for 7, 8 years. And because it was so small, just doing 40, 50,000 bike sales annually, the large companies were not even focused on it because too small for them. For someone like a Hero selling 5 million bikes a year or 6 million bikes a year, to focus on a segment with just 50,000 bikes per annum was just not feasible or not worth their time and effort from the organization's energy perspective. And that is where they focused on try to build that brand and position themselves there, waiting for the time that whenever growth comes, if they have a good product, then probably they should be a beneficiary of that. And that is what exactly happened post 2010, when a lot of customers, because of the rising income, wanted to migrate to high-end bikes. And that segment, which used to do 50,000 two-wheeler sales in 2010 or 9, today does 1 million bikes. We sell 1 million bikes in that segment. And these guys own 90% of the segment because there's no one else there. Now all the large companies, which are the incumbent in the sector, want to really get there. But what really happened as a process in the last 10 years is Hero, which iShare, which was actually a mid-cap, yeah, actually became a large company. It's a large cap. It's a nifty company now. So this company, the point I'm trying to make is, had leadership in high-powered bikes even 10 years back when it was mid-cap. They were the only player and they were the leaders there. And which is why they could really, when the growth really happened, they could really be the biggest beneficiary of that. And the kind of wealth creation that has happened in the stock in the last 10 years, I'm sure all of you are aware of it. So this is what I meant when I said that companies have to be leaders even when they are mid-cap or small-cap. They have to be leaders in their respective business. That's very important. To my mind, that's the path to creating low-risk, high returns when it comes to mid-caps or small-caps. The next company probably is, I'm sure all of you are familiar with it. So this is again a classic company. Very interestingly, they realize internet is a trend. India is changing. They run 2 or 3 businesses. One of the biggest businesses is a website called Naukri.com. Yeah, if you go back 10 years back, Times 15 years back, at least when I started my career, Times of India used to run a supplement called Ascent. Time Ascent. Sorry, I'm growing older. Yeah, Times Ascent on Wednesday, where used to have all these job classifieds. Yeah, last 15 years, you see Time Ascent is not there anywhere. Yeah, because all the job classifieds market, 80% of job classifieds market has moved online. Yeah, and these guys control 80% of that market with Naukri.com. India is a country where if there's high growth, there'll be scarcity of talent. You need to match talent, demand and use of talent, and it's a business with network effect. And if that be the case, then that business should keep growing for the next 15, 20 years because there'll be enough number of qualified professionals who'll keep looking for good jobs, and employers will go to a platform which offers them the widest variety of choice among the prospective, you know, so it creates its own network effect. There are another business called, you know, something called 99acres.com, which is a real estate business, online real estate business. My view is what has happened to the jobs classified market in the last 15 years will happen to the real estate classified market in the next 15 years, where 80% of real estate classified will move online. Because today's kids, yeah, they don't hold a physical newspaper and read it. They read their news on their handheld on the go. And if they are going to become the buyers of real estate, investors, buyers, whatever, then and if businesses have to reach them, they can't reach them on newspapers because they don't read newspapers. They use handheld device. So 80% of real estate classified market is going to move online. And if that be the case, he's one of the leading players there with 99acres.com. Yeah? And the third most important other business which you know they run is India is a large country. We still had 2% population growth. We have 2 crore people. We keep adding to our population every year, and which effectively means we have to have 1 crore marriages every year in India. Yeah, and that industry is also getting much more professionalized. It's not unlike the traditional ways. And they run a business of matchmaking called Jeevansathi.com. So if you believe that in India 1 crore marriages have to happen every year, then you need, there is a role for a lot of these aggregators who can play matchmakers, and that industry, because of the changing demographics, trends, and improving qualification, is also getting more organized. So the point I was making again here is, it's a company which used to be a small cap. When it got IPO, it was a mid cap. Now it's actually, I think it's on the verge of being a large cap. But I'm saying is, in all the three businesses that they are, they're among the top 2 or 3 players within their businesses. And then they have a couple of their investments in investee companies like Zomato's and so on and so forth. So that's what I meant when I talked about, you know, this whole journey of being a business leader while being a small or mid-cap company. These are the companies which, so these companies are leaders, and which is why they become large. So it's important to have that leadership trait or DNA even when you are mid or small. That is what will differentiate the men and the boys.
Yep.
I think I'll pause here, and we can take questions that relates to this or anything else that relates to.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Pankaj. That was an insightful peek into which are the businesses which can become big over the next decade. We have time for a couple of questions. So if you raise your hand or stand up, we can quickly reach a mic to you. One question I have, Pankaj, is you know, you often talk about the fact that in the stock market, leadership normally changes every decade. I mean, last decade, we've obviously seen the rise of financials, and many companies in the consumer space have become very large. And you have been talking about the fact that the next decade could see maybe very different winners. So could you elaborate on that opportunity, the next decade?
Sure. So that's a global phenomenon. Leadership does change, and stock market is a very dynamic, it's a voting machine, and it's a very dynamic voting machine. As I said, you know, at any point of time in any ecosystem, we have this certain set of companies which deliver a growth which is completely an outlier growth, which is what is, if you see the technology space, or which is what has happened in the technology space in US in the last 10 years, where the economy is growing at 2-3%, but some of these companies, you know, have just delivered phenomenal growth. I think in India, with growth and our changing demographics, Indian economy is going through a very interesting phase, where our drivers of growth over the next 10-15 years will be very different than what it has been for the last 5-10 years, kind of a thing, and which is where whole thing comes into play. I think one clearly factor which really stands out is the role of technology. I think technology is changing very rapidly, and the incremental learning on technology or the incremental disruption because of technology is happening at a very exponential pace. So the technology over the next 10 or 15 years is going to disrupt a lot of businesses which have been around for the last 5, 10, 15 years. Businesses who do not change or adapt themselves will be seriously challenged, and some of the business models could be challenged for the existence itself. And the good thing with technology is works in favor of customers because it improves productivity, efficiency, and so on and so forth. And I think we are in India, we are just at the cusp of it. So when I just think about this whole technology landscape and what it can do in India, now that we have a very high penetration of smartphones, adoption is very high. Costs have declined very significantly. You just look at the data consumption. 3 years back, average data consumption by a smartphone user was something about 2 GB. Today, that stands at 10 GB. It's gone 5x in the last 2 years. And data consumption will, meaning my view and whatever industry estimates I see, will keep growing at 15-20% CAGR for the next 5-7 years at least, and probably longer. In India, all of us just, for the lack of a better word, we are suckers of data. And I think the kind of impact it can do in terms of what a lot of businesses is can just be truly be mind-boggling.
Yeah, thanks. I think we have a question there in the audience, so if we can get a mic to him.
Hello.
Please go ahead, sir.
Thanks, Pankaj. Very elaborate. Just one question on the CRAM space. You mentioned that as one of the first wave, but my question is that opportunity has been there for quite a while. I'm in the healthcare space, I've been looking at it for last 10 years, that opportunity has been there, but has never been able to pick up because of the regulatory issues around it. We don't allow a lot of clinical research in India. So is there a change that you think which has happened in the recent past and that's why you put it in the big wave?
So what happens is every industry at some point of time its evolution reaches some inflection point. IT companies, Infosys did not start in 95. Infosys started in 83, 84. Yeah, the IT inflection point happened in 95. My experience tells me there are a lot of global and local factors which align at certain point of time for an inflection point to happen for a business or an industry, and from there the growth really takes a J-curve kind of a thing, and it's always a mix of global and local factors. And I think that industry has reached, so we have a lot of CRAM companies and they've done well in the last 5-10 years, but I think that industry has now reached inflection point in terms of their ability to do what they're supposed to do, in terms of when you talk about regulators and all of that. See, all of regulators also go through their own learning cycle. So just imagine IT happened in 1984. I remember this story of Infosys. Those days in India, we used to have these MTNL and BSNL of the world, and to get one telephone connection was 10-12 year or something like that. I was very young at that point of time, so I don't recollect, but whatever I've read, used to take 10 or 12 years to get one telephone connection at your home. Now just imagine IT companies doing data transmission at a broadband speed of whatever, 2GB, 4GB, that point of time would have been a high speed network that point of time. Today we use 4GB, 5GB on our handset. Yeah, trying to do that at that point of time, and obviously then the sector, enabling sectors in terms of telecom bandwidth, broadband and all of that have happened. So a lot of these things, then they fall gradually in place when the regulators, governments learn, realize that they need to do certain things to support or to accelerate growth and all of that. My understanding, my interaction with companies here globally, seeing the trends, macro trends globally, seeing here, I think all of those things are falling in place. And unfortunately, the world has no other choice, as it was with IT. Yeah, there's no other country which could have, in the world, which could have provided such skilled engineers. China then, until then, and maybe I would not say today, but then was largely known for unskilled workers, not known for skilled workers. In 90s, to provide skilled workers on that scale as a solution to the global problem, there was no other country which could have provided, you know, lakhs of engineers every year. And today, I think we are at the same point where the kind of skills this industry needs and the kinds of skill sets and at the cost that they need, I don't think so any other country can fill in those shoes, except for India. So I think, and there's a lot of learning that has happened in the ecosystem, be it regulators, governments, globally, locally, customers, companies here and all of that. So I think this trend is reaching some sort of an inflection point where we'll see a J-curve growth. That's my view over the next 10 years.